Hello, and welcome to the Water Research Foundation webcast, Greenhouse Gas Emissions Strategies for Water Utilities. My name is Linda Rieke, and I'm a project manager with the Water Research Foundation. I will be the moderator for today's session. As a world citizen and a water professional, I am sure you are increasingly aware of the importance of controlling greenhouse gas emissions, made evident through the media coverage, increasing political attention, and an increasing body of scientific literature on climate change. 2 years ago, the Water Research Foundation and the California Urban Water Agencies partnered to jointly fund a tailored collaboration project that was sponsored by the Santa Clara Valley Water District. The objective of the project was to develop a guidance for water utilities to inventory greenhouse gas emissions directly or indirectly caused by their operations. The full report is now available to Foundation subscribers as a downloadable PDF on the Water Research Foundation website or as a printed publication. For the PDF, go to the Foundation website Project Center and search for Project 4156. Click on Report on the right-hand side of the webpage, and that will present you with a new webpage with a PDF link available for download. This webcast will provide a background and overview of the publication. It will provide information on the development of greenhouse gas emission reporting and will identify some drivers for water utilities to move forward to inventory greenhouse gases. It will also present a framework that water utilities can use to inventory their greenhouse gases. Before I introduce our presenter, Doug Huxley, I wanted to remind viewers that following this presentation, there will be a brief question and answer period. You can enter your questions directly through the webcast webpage by typing your question either during or after the presentation. If we are unable to get to everyone's questions during today's webcast, we will provide answers to those questions that will be available along with a full download of the entire webcast on the Water Research Foundation website early next week. Well, I'd like to introduce today's presenter, Doug Huxley, who was the principal investigator of the project Greenhouse Gas Emission Inventory and Management Strategy Guidelines for Water Utilities. Mr. Huxley is a principal technologist with CH2M Hill and is currently serving as the Global Practice Director for Climate Change Services within the Industrial Systems Business Group. He has more than 20 years of combined experience as a consulting engineer and as an employee of three industrial chemical manufacturers. His experience includes engineering and project management on Clean Air Act, Title V, acid rain and new source review permitting, industrial design, RCRA permitting and remedial action, Superfund remedial action and oversight, and greenhouse gas emission inventory and reduction. He has a BS in chemical and petroleum refining engineering from the Colorado School of Mines. With that, I'll turn the presentation over to Doug.
Thank you, Linda. I appreciate everybody's attendance today, and I appreciate the chance to talk not only about the results of our tailored collaboration project, but also to provide perhaps a broad framework and for how water utilities might approach greenhouse gas management. I've been doing climate change consulting for nearly 10 years now, and the level of activity we've seen on the regulatory side as well as client attention and other drivers is really unprecedented, especially in the last few months. So I know that we've got a very timely topic here. I do have a lot of material to present, so I'm going to roll right into it. The main intent of the presentation today, or some of the elements of the presentation, we want to give an introduction to the tailored collaboration projects and the results of the manual, but then to talk more broadly about drivers for action, regulatory and other reasons why we see water utilities taking action. I'd like to describe briefly some of the existing greenhouse gas protocols and registries that are common in the industry and were really the basis for a lot of what we were pulling together in the guidance manual. We'd be talking about greenhouse gas accounting fundamentals. I know that we've really got a broad range of of experience and expertise in this area with the audience. So I would like to start at the start and give some of the basic concepts around greenhouse gas accounting, as well as then going into a little bit more depth about how some of the key emission sources for water utilities are estimated. And finally, to wrap up with some thoughts on development of greenhouse gas management strategies, both in terms of sort of the direct and indirect emissions of water utilities operations, as well as what they can influence in the broader sphere of influence or impact of their operations. First, I'd just like to have a few acknowledgments regarding the Tailored Collaboration Project. The Santa Clara Valley Water District provided both financial contributions as well as a high level of expertise and experience that we brought to the program. Our project advisory committee, including California Urban Water Agencies and East Bay Municipal Utility District, Seattle Public Utilities, Stratus Consulting, Association of California Water Agencies, and Malcolm Perney all provided a lot of expertise that contributed to our work, as did the other CH2M Hill team members that supported me in the work. When the genesis of the Tailored Collaboration Project was developing, there were really three principal goals that we were looking to satisfy in developing this guidance manual. First was simply guidelines for water utilities in the assessment of their emissions inventory and their emissions footprint. Second was to, as necessary, to develop estimation protocols specific to the water industry for potential acceptance by California Climate Action Registry, the Climate Registry, and other bodies that are managing registries of greenhouse gas emissions, as well as to provide that high-level framework for how utilities might go about starting the process of developing strategies and managing their emissions and reducing their emissions. On the point of the specialty protocol, I would say that this work followed some work that the wastewater industry was doing, and in fact CH2M Hill still is quite involved with in developing specialty protocols for wastewater treatment. And in that case, there are significant process-related greenhouse gas emissions, and in those emissions really were not well characterized by some of the existing literature out there. So in the case of the wastewater industry, you know, that need for a specialty protocol certainly existed. But as we got into the project for the water industry, we really found that with the exception of some relatively minor emission sources, most of what water utilities influenced were well characterized by the existing protocols. So we felt that doing a specialty protocol might be somewhat unproductive. There's a lot of information on this next slide about what's contained in the guidance manual, but just briefly, what we've tried to cover was again the accounting fundamentals and relevance of existing protocols to water utilities. We wanted to really dive into emissions estimation techniques that were key to the water industry. Provided some background information on how to estimate some of those smaller emission sources that were really some of which were pretty unique to water utilities. I'll talk a little bit more about those later. We gave some information on accounting issues relative to on-site renewable energy generation. In particular, our emphasis there was on hydro generation and some of the issues about how the utilities' carbon footprint might be impacted depending on where that power is consumed and who else might be claiming carbon benefits of that action. And also in the same vein, talking about impact of water conservation projects and reductions in energy by other parties besides the water utility on the water utility's footprint. And again, providing a roadmap for how climate change mitigation strategies might be developed. Definitely not a goal of the manual was to prescribe any policy. For example, on the renewable energy issues that I just mentioned, we very much tried to stick to educating the user of the manual on the issues, but not prescribing what the answer should be. And similarly, we understand that most users of the manual are going to be reporting to a voluntary or a mandatory reporting registry. And there are some small differences between the guidance documents for those registries, and in addition, emission factors and in particular around electricity are updated periodically. So we didn't try to have a manual that was really standalone. Rather, it provides background information with the recognition that our users are going to have to refer to the specific guidance documents of the program that they're reporting to. So why are utilities taking action at this point? What are some of the things that are driving them to get into this process? Before I really get into that question, I kind of want to start at the end, so to speak, and provide a view of an overall strategy. And I'm going to come back to the same figure again later. But what is an overall roadmap for approach to this look like? In the upper left-hand corner of this, we talk about setting directions and boundaries. So what all is included in the inventory, and what's the general direction that a water utility might be approaching? You see, under strategy and planning, we've broken it up into three main stages. First is to create the strategies and master plans. Stage two is focusing inward on investment plans and engaging the personnel of the organization. And stage three is focusing outwards around strategies for influencing policy and also in terms of external communications, external relations. Then stage one, step one, is assessing the profile and footprint. Step two would be gauging risks and opportunities, and those include regulatory drivers, stakeholder, public drivers. Then steps three and four, evaluating what options there might be to reduce emissions or to influence reductions outside of the boundary, and then based on that to set goals and targets. Again, stage two has to do with development of investment plans to fund those activities, and again, engaging personnel to make that happen. And then stage three, again, that outward focus on the utility's image and communications. You see the three arrows coming down out of various places into implementation, the design, construction, O&M, and monitoring and verification of various reduction things. And the reason we've got multiple arrows there is pretty clearly early in the process, some of the things with positive payback will be pretty obvious. Others are going to take a little bit more of an investment plan to make it happen, and then others will create a little bit more of a substantial strategy to make it happen. So again, throughout that continuum, there will be some activities, some options that are pretty clear cut, and others that are going to take more funding to make it happen. Briefly on some of the regulatory drivers, I know folks have probably heard a lot about the Waxman-Markey, or more accurately, the American Clean Energy and Security Act that passed the U.S. House of Representatives in June. And then just yesterday, we saw the companion Senate bill released for discussion by Senators Boxer and Kerry. Last week, we had the mandatory greenhouse gas reporting rule signed by the EPA administrator. Also yesterday, as a result of the Supreme Court decision and the endangerment determination, we had the proposal by EPA to regulate greenhouse gas emissions via the Clean Air Act. Similar cap and trade initiatives are coming through the various regional groups such as Western Climate Initiative, Midwest Greenhouse Gas Reduction Accord, Regional Greenhouse Gas Initiative, and certainly state regulations in some cases will drive this as well. As we'll discuss, in a lot of cases, we think that water utility emissions will fall below the thresholds that would cause them to be regulated by these programs, but certainly it's something that utilities need to assess. The American Clean Energy and Security Act, kind of key relevance here are Titles 3 and 5. Title 3 establishes the cap and trade program, which includes the program for trading of allowances as well as the establishment of an offset trading program. Title 3 also requires federal agencies to develop adaptation plans in response to climate change. And then Title 5 specifically establishes provisions for terrestrial offsets of carbon and would put Department of Agriculture in charge of managing those offsets. Just to put things in perspective, the emission reductions that are to be targeted by American Clean Energy and Security Act would be a 17% reduction relative to 2005 levels by the year 2020, and slowly increasing to an overall 83% reduction by the year 2050. So clearly, some pretty substantial reductions will be required across our economy to make that happen. Brief discussion here of the EPA mandatory reporting rule. As I said, it was signed by the EPA administrator last week on Tuesday. And in general, it requires reporting by the owners or operators of facilities that emit more than 25,000 tons per year of carbon dioxide equivalent greenhouse gas emissions from listed source categories. And that's the key. There's a series of listed source categories, and it's only emissions from those categories that are reportable under the rule. Of key significance there to water utilities will be stationary combustion emissions from facilities. And very notable, compared to other greenhouse gas reporting programs, there will be no reporting of emissions from the operators of vehicle fleets. There will be no reporting of what's termed the Scope 2 emissions related to the purchase of electricity. I mentioned just yesterday the proposal by EPA to regulate greenhouse gases under the Clean Air Act, or more specifically, the Prevention of Significant Deterioration Program. This again is an indirect result of the Supreme Court ruling that said that greenhouse gases meet the definition of an air pollutant. And EPA's draft endangerment determination that said that greenhouse gases present dangers to human health and welfare. It appears that the threshold for regulation under the proposed ruling would be emissions from facilities greater than 25,000 tons per year. However, we know there will be significant legal action because the current basis for Clean Air Act is emissions of 250 tons per year. So we expect EPA, or everybody's expecting EPA, to face some legal challenges there. As I mentioned, the Waxman-Markey, or the American Clean Energy Security Act, talks about climate change adaptation, which is changes in society's policies, practices, systems, infrastructure, and operations to manage the risks and impacts related to changes in the climate. And it's, especially for water utilities, it's a complementary action to mitigation, where mitigation is aimed at reducing the impacts and adaptation is related to changing in responses to those impacts. Specifically, the American Clean Energy Security Act would require each of 14 federal agencies within 1 year of publication to develop adaptation plans which address potential impacts, current and future, describing priorities for building adaptive capacity, and reviewing their efforts to address climate change. So I say this pertains more to federal agencies, but we expect that the result of that will be a roll down of adaptation planning needs to other parties. So if what do the regulatory drivers and other drivers mean to water utilities? Well, again, to a large part for federal programs or even some of the regional programs that are set on thresholds of 25,000 tons per year of direct emissions, in many cases, water utilities may be exempt from those cap and trade and reporting requirements. And for the most part, at this time, we're thinking that most state reporting thresholds would be similar. There is the potential that under legal challenge to the Clean Air Act authority, lower thresholds would be implemented. But nonetheless, the carbon markets may present opportunities for water utilities in development and trading of offsets. We see many other drivers why water utilities are taking action, including things such as environmental impact statement requirements through NEPA, CEQA, other state programs, requirements for funding by state agencies, shareholder and public pressure. There's really a lot of drivers why, even if the federal rules don't directly apply, a lot of utilities are trying to get involved with assessing their footprint and finding responses. And so then beyond that, beyond the initial need for footprint, why do we see water utilities setting reduction targets? Again, we see it as complementary to adaptation programs. Water utilities are really, at the forefront of the need to adapt, and thus there's significant interest in trying to be, part of the reduction or part of the mitigation as well. Many cases, community action plans, maybe initiatives from mayors or county commissions, would drive water utilities to participate in setting reduction targets. It's partly a recognition that utilities can have a significant impact beyond their own boundaries as well in influencing water users or influencing suppliers of water or materials into the utility. And simply the environmental stewardship question. A lot of parties interested in trying to be at the table to assist with solutions. Again, I've mentioned that our guidance manual in large part draws on existing protocols and registries. I'd like to briefly describe those. Probably the first major greenhouse gas protocol out there was from the World Resources Institute and World Business Council for Sustainable Development, the Greenhouse Gas Protocol. And it was the document on which many of these other registries were developed. The U.S. EPA, through their Climate Leaders Program and also National Greenhouse Gas Registries, our emission inventory have guidance documents. Department of Energy through their 1605B program. Another key here is the climate registry, which is being adopted by many states and many organizations as a reporting tool. Really, the sort of the predecessor to the climate registry was the California Climate Action Registry. A lot of staff from CCAR were involved with the development of the climate registry program and protocols. The ICLEI, the International Council for Local Environmental Initiatives, has a good guidance document, in addition to many other resource materials, a good guidance documents for local government development of emission inventories for municipal operations, and soon to be published is their protocol for development of community emission inventories. The Chicago Climate Exchange, through their registry and trading program, has documentation. The International Standards for Organization for Standardization, ISO, the 14064 program, has some good high-level guidance on development of entity-wide or corporate-wide emission inventories for inventory of reduction projects and also for verification of emission inventories. And finally, another document that we drew on was through the UKWIR had a workbook for quantifying greenhouse gas emissions from water and wastewater emissions, and in particular on some of the water specific emission sources, we drew on some information from that guidance document. Again, as I said, the greenhouse gas protocol from WRI, WBCSD really is a key document here, and anybody developing a greenhouse gas inventory, I would encourage them to go on that WRI website and to get a copy of this. It really is the basis for many other protocols. And in fact, specifically, there's two key documents on that site now. One is the Corporate Accounting and Reporting Standard, and the second is the Project Accounting Standard, really aimed at guidance on how to account for a specific projects that created reductions and offsets that might result from those. As I say, the other key is the Climate Registry and the General Reporting Protocol from that organization. You can see here on the map the number of states, Canadian provinces, and Mexican states that have adopted or will adopt this as the basis for a reporting program. The Climate Registry's original goal was to improve consistency and transparency between reporting programs and then to establish a high level of integrity and confidence in emissions reporting. So with that segue from some of the existing protocols that really lay out a lot of this guidance, I thought I will give a description of some of the fundamentals around greenhouse gas accounting. So starting at the start is a description of what are the greenhouse gases. For the most part, most programs are focusing on six gases or compounds of gases: the carbon dioxide, the methane, nitrous oxide, sulfur hexafluoride, HFCs, the hydrofluorocarbons, the PFCs, the perfluorocarbons. And in addition to these six, I would mention there are, several or a number of other greenhouse gases or other impacts that affect the climate, which are typically not included in inventories. Very notable here are the classic refrigerants, the CFCs and HCFCs, which were excluded from Kyoto because they were included in the Montreal Protocol. And again, many other programs have followed suit. There's other fluorinated compounds, some of which are mentioned in the Mandatory Reporting Rule and the American Clean Energy and Security Act. Other factors like carbon black, ground level ozone, water vapor, in fact, are greenhouse gases, but typically not really a focus. For water utilities, I would say it's these first three that are really going to be the vast majority of the focus: the carbon dioxide, methane, and nitrous oxide. Global warming potential, in simple terms, is a measure of the heat trapping impact of a greenhouse gas relative to CO2. It's a ratio to CO2. And that's why you see here in the table the global warming potential of CO2 is 1. The estimates of GWPs have changed with time, both based on changes to sources and sinks of carbon, but also based on updated science and understanding of atmospheric lifetimes of the gases in question. Because gases have different atmospheric lifetimes, there needs to be a time frame against which the GWP is assessed, and typically that's a 100-year time frame. And what you see here in the table are from the three most recent assessment reports of the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, which is really the key authority on GWPs. So SAR's second assessment report, TAR third assessment report, AR4's fourth assessment report. You can see that methane is in that 21 to 25 range on global warming potential. Nitrous oxide, approximately 300. Sulfur hexafluoride, greater than 20,000. The other fluorinated compounds ranging from from the low 100s to approximately 15,000 times as potent on a pound-for-pound basis, as is CO2. In terms of deciding what's in the inventory, usually the first step is around organizational boundaries, and I'll describe first the traditional approach that's really prescribed by the Greenhouse Gas Protocol, by the Climate Registry and Climate Leaders and other programs. And this is really aimed at assessing the total emissions impact of an organization, of a corporation or utility or government entity. And within that approach, there's really two allowable methods of defining that inventory. And one is based on equity share, which really says, especially for corporate operations where maybe there's a 50-50 joint venture or other partial ownership of a facility or operation, it would prescribe that the party doing the inventory account for emissions from all facilities in which they have ownership or partial ownership, prorated based on their fraction of ownership. So if it's a 50-50 joint venture, the party would include 50% of the emissions of that operation. The other key approach is the control approach, where regardless of percent ownership for any facility, which is really in the direct control, either EHS or operational or management, or in some cases financial control of that entity, the party doing the inventory would include 100% of the emissions from that facility. In the mandatory reporting rule, and really writing on the wall around the cap and trade programs, it'll be really a different mind frame. It's not going to be emissions of a total organization, but it will really be a facility by facility emission inventory. So it doesn't really matter who owns or operates that facility, but somebody from that facility better comply with the law and make sure that emissions are reported. I've got a couple of other slides here talking about emission scopes, but I thought I'd set the stage first here with the difference between what in the guidance manual we call the inventory or footprint. I would say across the inventory, people use the term footprint very differently depending on the situation. I would caution everybody to really understand what people mean by that term. But as we used it here, the inventory is really the emissions from the operations of the water utility. Scope 1, Scope 2 emissions, direct and indirect emissions. But then there's many other things that could be a part of the footprint. It could be outsourced operations. It could be the emissions from purchase of liquid oxygen or chemicals. It could be outsourced solids handling and transport. Could be upstream water conveyance into the utility system. So what we were trying to get across here is just a recognition that there's those things that would be directly reportable by a water utility, and then there's many other things that are influenced by the utility. Just briefly here, this figure kind of gives a graphical description of the difference between Scope 1, 2, and 3 emissions. Scope 1, or direct emissions, are really those directly emitted from a stack or a tailpipe, or fugitive emission sources from equipment or facilities owned or controlled by the party in question. Scope 2 is really it really focuses on purchased electricity, although steam and hot water and other utilities may be included, but it's the emissions that were a result from generation of the energy that was purchased by the party in question. By intent, that's a double counting. The electric utility would be counting those as a Scope 1 emission, and the consumer of that power would include it as a Scope 2. Again, as I've said, Scope 3 is really everything else that could be influenced by the party in question or the entity in question, or which may be a target for emissions reductions, or really what can be influenced, or what's an indirect result of the operations of that entity. So again, Scope 1 is direct emissions, and for water utilities, that's largely going to pertain to stationary combustion, such as space heating of buildings, emergency generators, as well as mobile combustions, the tailpipe emissions from fleet vehicles, Scope 2 is, in many cases, going to be really the biggest impact, and that's the impact from purchased electricity. We recently saw an example from a utility in the Pacific Northwest that actually had very small Scope 2 emissions, but that was because their electric power that they were sourcing was largely hydro-generated and of low carbon footprint. But for many water utilities, Scope 2 will be the biggest impact. And then Scope 3 could be customers' use of the water, either transport or heating. It could be related to chemical purchases. And in particular, for some California utilities where, you know, for as an example, Colorado River water is diverted, that upstream transport of water could be a pretty significant Scope 3 impact. The guidance manual does talk about emissions estimation techniques for other sources, in particular nitrous oxide byproduct of ozone generation, carbon dioxide from on-site granular activated carbon regeneration, methanes from water impoundments, reservoirs, emissions from sludge management, and nitrous oxide from biological denitrification. Again, we found all of these to be pretty small, thus we didn't really see the need to do a specialty protocol, but nonetheless, these emissions should be assessed and included, and we give some guidance on how to go about doing that. We've suggested in the development of emission inventories that the water utilities consider breaking these up into six sectors. And I know there's some representatives from other types of organizations in the audience. This was really focused on water utilities. So that the more meaningful information for benchmarking against other organizations can be developed, as well as improved ability to track opportunities and impact of reduction projects internally. We've suggested breaking it down into the source water, the treatment, distribution, buildings and infrastructure, and where we understand infrastructure might be construed to mean pipes and pumps. We're really talking about the supporting operations here. Fleet vehicles and other which may include offsets or other sorts of things. Part of the reason for breaking it down this way, we realize there's significant differences in the energy needed to source water based on elevation changes or other factors. And treatment energy might differ based on quality of the water coming in and types of treatment systems. And again, distribution may vary based on distances and elevation. So in order to really be able to make meaningful comparisons, we felt breaking it down into these six categories would be useful. So going beyond the fundamentals and into quantification techniques, there's really three key methods for assessing emissions. One, very uncommon for water utilities, but it would be direct measurement, and in particular continuous emission monitoring systems or SEMs. You know, very much a part of electric utilities, but not very common for other types of industries. Most common is the use of activity data and emission factors, where a sort of a surrogate parameter is measured, and then that's matched up with an emission factor that relates the greenhouse gas emissions to that throughput. A key example here being quantity of natural gas burned multiplied by a published emission factor that's based on the average properties of natural gas. And then in some cases, mass balances are used, and probably the key example here is around emissions of refrigerants where the total purchases of refrigerants combined with changes in inventory and combined with any returns of refrigerants to manufacturers are used to assess total emissions. As an overview of how to assess emissions from electricity purchases, I'd say, you know, clearly what we're talking about here is mostly emissions from fossil fuel fired generation, because the intensity of the level of emissions per megawatt hour varies based on the kind of fossil fuel as well as the mix of other generation sources. area-specific or geographically specific information is needed to assess this. So it can either, though, that data can either come from the specific electric utility, or else grid average emission factors for particular areas can be used. Again, the emission factors could come from the electric utility if they're available, and in a lot of cases that's pretty difficult for parties to use. So the other default is the eGrid database, which is available on the U.S. EPA website, and it gives emission factors for each grid subregion of the country. And I'll show the next slide shows that graphically. So it really comes down to total annual electricity consumption by utility sector, by facility as rolled up, and multiplied by the selected emission factor to get those the total electrical emissions. I've said the EPA eGrid database, which is really based on Department of Energy data, provides good default factors by region of the country. And again, it's really broken down to the electrical grid subregions. It's not state boundaries because electrical wires, grid systems don't really follow the state boundaries. It's really, a recognition of the fact that in purchasing grid power, you might have a contract with a particular utility, but the consumer of the power is really not sure which electrons are coming into their organization. So that's really kind of the fundamental reason here for why default electrical data is based on grid subregion. Mobile source emissions, as like fossil fuel generation or other combustion sources, really the key three emission factors are carbon dioxide, methane, and nitrous oxide. CO2 emissions really depend only on the characteristics of the fuel, characteristics and quantity of the fuel, and not the type of vehicle. So the CO2 emissions really fundamentally just come down to quantity of fuel and the carbon content of that fuel. On the other hand, the methane and nitrous oxide emissions are very much dependent on engine pollution control technology as well as fuel. And those emissions are generally correlated by miles and not by gallons of fuel. So it's helpful to have both mileage and fuel in doing mobile source emissions estimates, but where that data might not exist, the EPA website, the fueleconomy.gov, can be used to get estimated fuel economy to convert gallons to miles or vice versa. In stationary combustion, again, is mainly relevant to buildings, emergency generators, and other sources at water utilities. And again, it comes down mostly to quantity and characteristics of fuel. So in most cases, standard emission factors can be used to estimate those emissions. See, I've got about 6 minutes here, so I'm going to try to quickly cover some of the material here in my remaining 9 slides or 10 slides. And bringing it back to the roadmap, and it a lot of the management strategy planning comes down to assessing risks and opportunities, and comparing that to emissions, and developing a strategy for where the best investments might lie. Really getting it down to specific details of what kinds of projects might be involved for water utilities, and clearly energy efficiency is up there near the top of the list, both for buildings and facilities as well as for water conveyance systems, where that electricity for water conveyance is one of the big impacts. Clearly, it should be a big target. Alternative fuels, biofuels for buildings or vehicles, generation or sourcing of renewable energy might come into play. Management of mobile sources by types of sources, as well as logistics. Many water utilities have significant land holdings where perhaps forestry and terrestrial sequestration projects might come into play. And there's other things that a utility might do outside of their own boundary that would create reductions. And finally, simply going to the market to purchase renewable energy credits or else carbon offsets could have a factor. We wanted to bring into play here the life cycle analysis considerations, both operational, thinking about where water is sourced, chemicals are sourced, other types of external operations and how those might impact day-to-day operations, as well as life cycle planning of capital improvement projects, considering the overall impact of embedded carbon in concrete and steel, emissions from construction vehicles, as well as estimated lifetime operational emissions to really plan those projects with the lowest overall impacts. The figure I've got here on the slide is from a tool that CH2M Hill developed for this purpose. It's not the only tool out there, but we think it provides a pretty good basis for overall comparison of the embedded carbon, construction vehicles, other scope 3 emissions, and operational emissions. Some considerations around renewable energy accounting are described in the manual. Again, I guess the key message here is that generation of renewable energy by a utility does not necessarily represent an offset of the utility's emissions. There's a lot of considerations. There'll be a lot of program-specific details that need to be considered, but really it's fundamentally going to come down to a question of where is the power consumed and what other parties might be claiming the carbon credit, either through a low emission factor or the fact that perhaps this power was already included in the grid emission factors for that region. So the key message here, not to assume that renewable energy generation is automatically an offset. Similarly, water conservation projects, there was a lot of attention placed on whether customer energy savings through water conservation could be included in a utility's inventory. And again, we would caution that there's a lot of issues around really whose emissions are reduced. Is it the electric utility? Is it the consumer? Is it the water utility? Certainly the water utility saves energy by reducing throughput, but in terms of that external focus, we would caution that some of these issues need to be considered carefully before they're really included in a utility's inventory. Just briefly on carbon offsets, offsets are a tradable commodity representing a reduction or sequestration of carbon, and these may present opportunities for utilities to get involved in the market and perhaps creating a revenue source, but we would caution that there's a lot of accounting standards. Probably one of the most common questions I get is, we helped our clients save energy, can we sell offsets? And there's both specific methodologies that need to be followed as well as carbon accounting principles. Just graphically here, what is an allowance? Well, it can be if a party has exceeded their reduction threshold or has not met it, allowances and offsets can be used by other parties to make up the gap. As I mentioned, there's many accounting standards, and the voluntary carbon standard might be one key place to go look. The climate registry guidance would have some information on this as well. But additionality will be the key principle that you hear about with offsets. And in order for a reduction to count as an offset, it both must be additional to regulation. It cannot have been required by law, regulation, emission permit, consent decree. But traditionally, there's a series of investment or implementation barriers designed to make sure that business as usual is not being counted as an offset. So again, there's a lot of guidance document out there, but the takeaway is that not all emission reductions count as offsets. There's protocols describing specific types, and then there's typically a series of investment steps. So the final two slides before we get into a couple of questions, I'd like to wrap up with a description of some short-term steps towards a development of a strategy. First, again, is simply the footprint, both inside of your own boundaries as well as in the broader sphere of influence. Understand what emissions are being impacted. Understanding what regulations might apply and other things such as environmental impact statement requirements for new projects. Identify the other drivers, including your own environmental stewardship goals. Think about data management and what that's going to take to really have a comprehensive, transparent inventory across your operations. Understanding what your reduction priorities are and analyze and prioritize those. And set reduction goals to drive internal internal participation by your staff and to drive innovation. Integrate carbon reduction into your capital improvement projects and design projects. Again, thinking beyond your own operational emissions to the impact of embedded carbon and other life cycle impacts. And then finally, develop and implement the external communication plan. Silence is not a great option these days. Figure out how you're going to let the public, your stakeholders, your customers know what your position is on and what actions are being done to mitigate and adapt to impact of climate change. Finally here, the last slide, we'll try to answer as many questions as we can, but just in case if there's any questions that don't get answered, the three of us listed here, myself, Priya, Seth, Ann, and Ryan, and Bill Bellamy would all be good contacts to follow up with for additional information. With that, Linda, I will turn it back to you to go through some of the specific questions.
Thank you so much, Doug, for a lot of good and relevant information for the participants of this webcast. We do have a few questions that came up, and let me start with this one. Does the EPA reporting requirement for facilities emitting greater than 25,000 ton per year apply to all facilities owned by one utility or each individual facility?
The reporting rule is very much a facility-based emission. So it is individual facilities, and in general we've seen that definition of facility follows pretty well with traditional Clean Air Act definitions and Title V permitting type definitions, but again it is a facility-based reporting threshold and not an entity-wide reporting level as with the other protocols.
Okay. Does the cap and trade program allow trading carbon offsets across national boundaries?
It will depend on the program, and I would say that on the federal level, that's still very much in negotiation in Congress. And without federal action, we may see the regional climate programs that I've mentioned take on more influence. As it stands right now, trading of offsets into the United States would be allowable. In the House proposal, there would be a cap. Right now, the total U.S. national emissions are about 8 billion tons per year, and the House proposal would set a cap at total offsets of 2 billion tons per year, of which 50% could be sourced internationally, although on certain price triggers, that could increase to 1.5 billion tons. In the Senate proposal that came out yesterday, I understand that, again, total offsets are 2 billion tons, but international offsets would be limited to one-half of a billion tons per year. In general, in terms of trading offsets outside of the United States, there are some voluntary mechanisms, but in general, there are not many international purchasers of offsets from the United States because the United States was not a participant in the Kyoto Protocol. Therefore, offsets created in the United States cannot be counted towards Kyoto obligations in Europe or elsewhere. So in general, there's not a big market for offsets to flow outside of the U.S. borders.
Great. Another question. Can a utility credit offsets it produces within its operational boundaries against its total emissions to reduce its reported total net emissions? An example might include forestry practices on utility-owned land.
If I understand the question, is it if we're looking at a facility-based regulation, can offsets from elsewhere in the same organization count towards that facility? The answer would be yes, probably, as long as that other reduction really would qualify as an offset per the protocols and accounting principles. Certainly within a voluntary reporting framework or an entity-wide reporting framework like the voluntary like the climate registry. Again, it's entity-wide, so a reduction at a facility would inherently count as a reduction. In that case of forestry, which is, you know, emissions from the forest really not being a reportable emission, but a increase in sequestration being an amount that could be creditable, the answer would be yes, generally. I think most of the reports are going to show a top line emission and then show an offset against that. So again, there need to be some rigorous documentation of the benefits of that forestry project, but it should be something that would be creditable back against that entity-wide emission inventory.
Would leak detection and repair be considered a decrease in the utility greenhouse gas emission?
I'm assuming here by leak detection and repair that we're talking about natural gas emissions and leaks from natural gas pipelines. I think there would be some issues around accurate quantification of that reduction that may be problematic. Also, in terms of the concept of counting that as an offset, there might be some issues. Now, if that utility voluntarily included leaks from the pipeline in its inventory and then showed that in the second year those leaks were reduced, certainly it's an inherent part of the inventory. But to only try to count the reduction from the pipeline without reporting the emissions from the pipeline would probably be an issue. My other comment on that is in the draft version or the proposed version of the EPA reporting rule, there was significant emphasis on leaks of fugitive methane from the natural gas industry, and in large part due to all of the accounting issues and the instrumentation issues associated with measuring those leaks accurately, EPA deferred including those natural gas systems in the final rule and intends to publish reporting guidelines for those in the future. So again, in summary, it's difficult to include a reduction without including the emissions, and there are some real issues with accurate quantification and measurement of those emissions that might present challenges here.
Mm-hmm. One last question. Who would be the typical entity the carbon offsets would be traded with, and would this be national or international entities?
As I've mentioned earlier, domestic offsets are mainly going to be traded domestically. There are registries out there, such as the Voluntary Carbon Registry, that in some ways serve as clearinghouses. There's certainly a lot of brokers out there eager to connect buyers and sellers, and there's also many other parties that are out there managing portfolios of carbon in order to reduce risks, portfolio risks for their clients. So there's a lot of parties in the industry involved in carbon trading, but ultimately most of the buyers are corporations interested in voluntarily reducing their own footprint, and which will soon, have compliance needs to comply with emission caps, and thus would look towards offsets as an alternative to auctioning of allowances. So the ultimate buyers are typically corporations for the most part, but there are a number of mechanisms out there by which those offsets can be put onto the market.
Well, Doug, I want to thank you so much for providing the information on the greenhouse gas emission inventory and management guidelines for water utilities. And I want to thank all the participants for joining us. please do, for the questions that we didn't answer, check our website. We will provide written answers to the questions over the next couple of days. So with that, everybody, have a great afternoon.